Good morning. Welcome to Mayo Church. Good God of dreams and Lord of visions, we wish for eyes to see and ears to hear, for hearts and minds that will respond to all that you reveal to us. Good God of dreams and Lord of visions, with eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts and minds to understand, that those we seek to help today may be the very ones anointed to reveal the paths of salvation that we are yet to walk. Will you open your bulletin and share with me our call to worship? May God be gracious to us and bless us.
His face shine upon us and bring us peace.
Let all people praise you, O Lord.
Let all people shout their joy to your holy name.
God blesses us continually throughout our lives.
Thanks be to God for eternal love and blessing. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Heavenly Creator, illuminate our minds to the ways you love so deeply. Give us the wisdom to be yours in a hurting world. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome this morning to Mayo Memorial United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Amy Chapman, and it's a joy to be here with you on this sixth Sunday of Easter as we gather together to worship the Lord our God. Let's do so by singing our praise to God. Would you stand and sing together hymn number 577, God of Grace and God of Glory.
Crown thy nation.
in that peace of Christ that reigns among us here. Welcome those of you who are worshiping with us online this morning. You may be seated as our children. If you would like to be dismissed downstairs with Miss Donna, Miss Christie will lead the way. I saw Miss Donna carrying in some cups with flowers in them, so I know we're planting some seeds today. So we are praying for you as you go and you learn in Sunday school this morning. God be with you.
As we go into our announcement time, today at 4 p.m. will be the district conference at Louisa. Is anyone invited to that?
Yes, that's open.
That's okay. So that is open to anyone to come. And that's at Louisa United Methodist Church. And also this evening at 7 p.m. is Paintsville's Baccalaureate. Is that open to everyone too? Or is that just...
Good luck.
Yeah, okay. It's usually a crowd.
Yeah.
Yeah, usually, even with just family, it's a crowd. So,
if you're a church member here, we would gladly welcome you just to help with crowd control, direct anyone that needs assistance, doesn't know where the bathrooms are, things that like that. So if you would like to attend, I'd be glad to welcome you.
And, of course, our Tuesday morning Bible study at 10:30 and Wednesday evenings at 6:30. And are there any other announcements that need to be brought to our attention? We'll go into our prayer joys and concerns. Our birthdays this week. Today is Mary Small's birthday. And also tomorrow is Michael Schmidt's birthday. This week. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries we've left out? No. Any joys or prayer concerns anyone would like to share?
This week she had surgery. It was extremely
will turn in our hymnals for our morning psalter. It's Psalm 67. And you can find that on page 791. And then be prepared to go straight into our prayer hymn, number 133. God, be gracious to us and bless us and make your face to shine upon us.
That your ways may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us.
God has blessed us.
Let all the inhabitants of the earth fear God.
People, be glad and sing for joy. Declare God's glory in every land. God, we gather now as your people, as this community of faith called here together. We come, O God, to be in your presence, to listen, to confess our sin before God, to lean on the everlasting arms of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, we thank you that in you we find our strength. In you, O God, we find our comfort. In you, O God, we find eternal life. God, we confess that sometimes we do have things to dread. We do think of things to fear. God, we confess that oftentimes we keep our focus and our mind on those things instead of leaning in and leaning on the everlasting arms of our Lord. God, and in this community, we also lean. We lean to one another, recognizing, God, that even though there is distance between us, between the pews, between us here, that this is the family of God. And so, God, you have called us here as your people. And we gather now in prayer in the name of Christ. We thank you, God, that your love is from everlasting to everlasting. We ask, God, that you would help us now to pray in the assurance of that truth, the assurance of our salvation, to know that in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. God, what a joy it is to name our friends, our family, our loved ones, our co-workers, to know, oh God, that you hear each name, and that in the hearing, God, we are called to act as your church. We thank you, God, for the gift of being called on in prayer. We thank you, God, that you have heard the prayers for Ashley's friend. We praise you, God, today that he is healed in the name of Jesus Christ. We ask, God, that that would be true tomorrow and in the days to come. We pray in faith for this dear friend and give you thanks and praise. In your mercy, O Lord, hear our prayer. God, we thank you just for the testimony of where you have been with us, that we are able to look back and to recognize, God, the ways that your mighty hand has saved us, yet once again allowed us to be here in this space and in this day. This day, O God, that you have made, our hearts rejoice and are glad. We pray, O God, for Ashley as she continues the dangerous work of traveling, of visiting hospitals. God, it's sad that it's dangerous, but it's true that all around us in the world. But God, what a joy it is to not allow dread or fear to rise up in us, but to go forth in joyful obedience, knowing, God, that you have called us, that you are with us. We ask, God, that you would continue to travel with Ashley and all of us, God, who travel for work into these places, God, that should be safe places. But God, we know there is nowhere without harm. And yet, oh God, we trust that you are leading us, that you are keeping us in your care and in your will. For all of these things, oh God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, for our friend Barb, for her beloved friends that she carries to us so graciously, we lift to you the name of her friend Tess today. The name of her friend Jonathan. In your mercy, O Lord, hear our prayer. God, continue to be with Barb as well as she continues to find treatment for her pain. And we ask, God, that you would continue, God, your healing work in her body and in her life. For our beloved sister Barb, in your mercy, O Lord, hear our prayer. God, we ask that you would continue to be with Bunk as he is at home recovering, and that you would remind him, God, that he is dearly loved by this church family, but most importantly, God, by the Spirit of Christ that dwells with him now in his heart. God, minister to him in this time of need. For our beloved brother Bunk, in your mercy, O Lord, hear our prayer. God, we give you thanks for all the celebrations that we that we have named, for all of the good times. And God, we lift to you even now in our hearts the places of prayer, oh God, that we aren't even able to speak because they're so intimate and dear to us. God, you hear us even as we pray now in the silence. Hear us now, O Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And amen.
I'm so excited to share the scripture with you this morning. It is phenomenal. It makes my heart leap. That takes a lot for me. That's my little confession there. But Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, let me do that again. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, he was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.
We prepare to give of our tithes and offerings at this time. May we reflect on just how gracious God has been to us. Thank you.
God of the mountains and the valleys, of the dry places and oceans, your voice speaks to us across creation. The flowers and the trees sing of your majesty, and the stars of the night speak of how much we still don't know. As we offer gifts to you and speak our words of gratitude, help us to hear your voice anew. Give us ears to hear, faith to believe, and determination to truly listen to how you would send us into a hurting world. In Christ we pray. Amen.
Good morning again. Journeying along through our narrative lectionary year as we approach the day of Pentecost. In this sixth Sunday of Easter, we're getting really, really close to that day. It's just in two more Sundays when we will celebrate the birth of the church. But today, we move from the Acts of the Apostles, which we have decided should have been called the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Instead, we move to the church of Philippi, to the book of Philippians, where Paul writes to his partners in ministry, and he calls them that, the partnership of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he writes to them, I believe, saying something sort of like, howdy, partner. If you're an old John Wayne fan, my papa Walters used to have Westerns playing in his house all the time, and I never really understood what was going on. But I knew something good was about to happen when John Wayne would say, howdy, partner. You know, so turn over with me in your Bibles, if you would, to page 1151, or if you brought your own Bible this morning, and make this a time of being in God's Word, of hearing from the Holy Spirit, as we look together at the passage of Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, the first part of that verse there. This is Paul writing to the Philippians. And let me find what I did with it. There it is. Starting in verse 1, Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi with the bishops and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with you in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart. For all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness how I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight, to help you determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Christ Jesus for the glory and praises of God. I want you to know, beloved, that what has happened to me has actually helped to spread the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to everyone else that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers and sisters, having been made confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, dare to speak this word with greater boldness and without fear. Some proclaim Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. These proclaim Christ out of love, knowing that I have been put here for the defense of the gospel. The others proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but intending to increase my suffering in my imprisonment.
What does it matter? Paul says. Just this, that Christ is proclaimed in every way, whether out of false motives or true. And in that, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. Beloved, this is the word of God. For we, the people of God, thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Oh God, what a joy it is knowing that you are present with us. We thank you, oh God. We thank you every time that we gather together. Help us, oh God, to think of one another in true love today. To know that the good works that have begun here will be brought into completion by Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, rest upon us now as we come into this time of hearing your word. And oh God, would you be with me, the one who preaches, that my words would be pleasing to you and you alone. For you, oh God, are my rock and my redeemer. In Christ's holy name I pray. Amen. Every congregation has a beginning, doesn't it? Every congregation has a beginning. The church at Jerusalem began on Pentecost with the coming of the Holy Spirit, which I said we will celebrate here in just a couple of weeks. The preaching of the apostles back in Acts chapter 2. The church of Samaria, we found in Acts 8, began with Philip's preaching the word. New church planted. The Kentucky Annual Conference started this thing called New Church Development several years ago with the idea of where have we not yet gone? And that's what's happening here in these early days of the church. Little churches popping up everywhere so that the name of Jesus Christ becomes known. The church at Corinth began with Paul at the end of his second missionary journey over in Acts 18. And we were just here a few weeks ago at the church in Philippi when Paul, hearing the Macedonian call, you might remember he thought he was going one way, but the Spirit went whoop and turned him around and called him another way. And we found Paul with his team in Acts 16 after the conference in Jerusalem regarding whether a man had to be circumcised to be saved. Paul and Barnabas decided to visit the churches they had established on their first journey to confirm them in the faith and to tell them of the results of this meeting. And there was a dissension there that arose regarding whether to take John Mark with them. And so Barnabas and Paul separated, and that's how they ended up going sort of their separate ways. Barnabas sailed with Mark to Cyprus. Paul and Silas journeyed overland to Lystra. And in Lystra, Timothy joined them as a co-worker. And we found them there, the Holy Spirit leading them in that way, forbidding them to go one way, but going over, God said to Paul, come, he heard in a vision, come over into Macedonia and help us. Remember that? And in obedience, Paul and Silas, Timothy and Luke went straight through Asia to Macedonia, which is modern-day Greece and Turkey, as if the Lord was in a hurry there for the gospel to reach that area. And indeed, they did make converts. You might remember they were locked away, Paul and Silas in chains. The chains fell off when they began to pray. All the prisoners were set free. The jailer himself was converted because of Paul's graciousness toward him and Paul's telling of the gospel of Jesus Christ. They all gathered around the table and broke bread together in Holy Communion. Their eyes were made open and that church began to grow. Thus, Paul and Silas continued that mission of the Great Commission to go ye therefore into the world to make disciples of all nations. They brought the gospel there. That is the beginning of that church in Philippi. And that is where Paul is writing his letter today. What a wonderful memory. Of course, he thanks God every time he remembers the church in Philippi. They hold a special place in his heart. Paul wrote to this church about 10 years later after this occurrence happened. Scholars think that this was probably one of Paul's actually last writings to a church that he would write from imprisonment. And they think that it was probably near the very end of Paul's life. Hindsight is indeed 20/20 vision, isn't it? And sometimes we grow more thankful the older we get, the more we can see, the bigger view we have, and we can look back the places that we've been. We can thank God for those places. We can remember and give thanks to God. And that's what Paul is doing here as he writes to this church in Philippi. who is still caring for him. This church would be a special place to Paul for the rest of his life. And here he writes to them, "Howdy, partner." Howdy, partner. Even in prison, Paul writes a letter of hope to the church in Philippi. This letter is a reminder that even though times are difficult, God isn't finished yet. Amen? Even though times are difficult, God isn't finished yet. Paul's writing from prison. There's no getting around the dire situation he finds himself in. Talk about living in fear and living in dread. All around him has to be fear and dread. Yet he's taking time to praise God, to write, to encourage and instruct the church of Philippi. In his writing, Paul writes prayerfully of the hope he has. He knows that God is not done with him. He's not done with the churches that he started. Paul firmly believes that God is spreading the gospel through his imprisonment, and that his story is spreading through the Roman guards even, and across the Roman Empire. The people of Philippi likely heard of Paul's imprisonment, and they may have been afraid, not just for Paul. Can you imagine? This church that he loves surely loves them too, and they're afraid for Paul. Maybe they're afraid for themselves as well. Maybe they're thinking, well, that this kind of behavior, this following of Jesus Christ, look where it's landed Paul. Are we sure about this? Are we sure we want to keep spreading this good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Yet Paul encourages the people of Philippi, don't lose heart, because God is with you, and I hold you in my heart, and God holds you in his heart. Not only that, he knows that they, no matter what, are also praying for him. What a special connection. So we stop now to consider our current predicaments. Whatever it is, may feel like imprisonment in our own lives. While we're, of course, we're free to be here, we celebrate that freedom of our own. We're free to spread the gospel. Our church doesn't face a whole lot of persecution to do so, doesn't it? But there's a lot of reality in anxiousness, in precautions, and things that would prohibit us from spreading the gospel. Things that prohibit us from really being obedient to the calling and the promise of Jesus Christ. Things that prohibit us from being the church, from being partners in the gospel. Paul says, "I am confident of this," in verse 6, "that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion of the day of Christ Jesus." I don't know if you have any friends who watch a television series that came out not too long ago. It's just on Apple TV, but it's a great little series. It's called Ted Lasso. You'll get a good laugh if you watch it. But one of his quotes that he says reminds me of this passage of Scripture, because he says, you say he's a soccer coach, and they're talking about the possibility of that team not winning. And Ted Lasso, the coach, says, "You say impossible, but I hear I'm possible." Right? You say impossible, but what I hear is I'm possible. And I feel like that's what Paul's saying here. Church in Philippi, you might feel like this is impossible. You might feel like this is not going to happen, that this might be the end. But I'm telling you, in Christ, all things are possible. God is possible. We can think of the present shifts in the life of the church and the spiritual lives of Christians as a bad thing, or we can see it as an opportunity, right? We can look at a shift in the world and we can say, oh no, this is it, we're doomed. Or we can say, in Christ, all things are possible. But we have to heed Paul's teaching today, and we have to ask ourselves, why? Why are we still called to spread the gospel? Maybe has it spread far enough? Was that for this time? Are there enough churches planted? Are there? What is the Spirit leading us to do today in response to this story, in response to this great commission? Not only is spreading the message of Jesus important still, I would argue, if not, what are we doing here, right? But the method of spreading the gospel, we read, is also important. This is an important part of Paul's message to the church in Philippi. Spreading the gospel might be through sharing our own faith story. It might be through acts of kindness or mission, acts of caring for the poor or the sick or the marginalized. It might be through advocating for justice, whatever it may be. There are so many important ways for us to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's important to do that in prayer. Paul, in prison, he feels tied down. Like, what can I do from here? Maybe you're watching from home and you think, what can I do from here? You can pray, brothers and sisters. Throughout the week, you can pray for one another. You can lift one another up. Most importantly, I think this passage of Scripture reminds us of the importance of having partners. Of having partners in the gospel. Who are your partners in spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ? As Paul writes to the church in Philippi, he says, I thank God for your partnership in the gospel. We might remember in Jesus' account with the disciples in chapter 9, an argument arises among the disciples as to which one is the greatest. But Jesus, in chapter 9, says, aware of their inner thoughts, took a little child and put it by his side and said to them, whoever welcomes this child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. For the least among all of you is the greatest. What a beautiful spirit. Our children can be partners in the gospel of Jesus Christ. What you do in your schools and in our communities, those are your partners. They're watching. They're learning. They're listening. And they know when there is a true unity among Christians. Children know. John Wesley is known for this quote, though we cannot think alike, may we not love alike. How beautiful. I think those are Paul's words here. Though we cannot think alike, may we not love alike. Because the church is getting some criticism. They've come to Paul to bring him, to care for him, to bring with money maybe in prison. I don't know if any of you visit folks in prison, but there's a great need there. There's a great need to minister to those who are in prison, and that's what we see happening here. The church in Philippi is ministering, sending out missionaries to go and to visit Paul, to bring things that will help care for him. And Paul reminds them, look, I know what's going on there. I know there are some who are preaching the gospel, and you might think, you know what, they're doing it for themselves. They're doing it for their own intent. I'm not even sure if we are partners in the gospel. And Paul says, you are. You're partners. You're partners. Why? Because you're preaching the same message of Jesus Christ. Paul says, I don't care who's preaching it. I don't care how they're preaching it. What does it matter? What does it matter as long as the gospel of Jesus Christ is being spread? Though we may not think alike, though we cannot think alike, that's an important adage there. Though we cannot think alike, may we not love alike? Yes, yes we can. Wesley's teaching reaches right to us today. And I'm challenged by it. I'm challenged by that. It's also kind of misunderstood a little bit, though. This is from sermon. This quote comes from Wesley's sermon called A Catholic Spirit. You might recognize that little C Catholic, because we say that every Sunday when we affirm our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in the Holy Catholic Church. That's a little C, and there's an asterisk beside it, and down at the bottom of the page, there's that word explaining what that word Catholic means. It's a universal. It's a universal. I believe in the Holy Catholic Church. I believe in the universal church. That's what Paul's saying here. I believe in that. I believe in it because Christ instituted it. I believe it's important for us to get along, to work side by side together, to not tear one another down in this Catholic spirit. Wesley didn't mean, of course, that there won't be doctrinal differences or beliefs, and he didn't gloss over those. Wesley had many strong beliefs, and he held them with great tenacity. Sometimes I read them and I'm like, oh man, that was rude. That was pretty bold. But he preached them with vigor, and we're welcome to do so. Surely God calls us to open our mouths when the Spirit leads. And Wesley did not shy away from engaging in serious debates with people over those differences, over those doctrinal differences. In fact, the first clause of this famous quote shows how much Wesley is a practical theologian who recognizes that, realistically speaking, there is no way to expect all of us to think alike on every matter. Though we cannot think alike, may we not love alike. We are limited. We are finite creatures who come from separate backgrounds, separate life experiences. There are matters of conscience and deeply held beliefs on which people of faith may differ. Rather than overlooking or explaining away those differences, it's more honest and more helpful to say we cannot think alike. We cannot think alike. But we can have unity within the body of Christ. We can have unity. The genius of John Wesley and of Paul here in this text, in this letter to the Philippians, is seen in this part. May we not love alike. Wesley knew that doctrine matters. Paul knew that doctrine matters. It's one of the reasons he was in prison. But he also knew something else. Wesley says this later in his essay called The Character of a Methodist. He says that Methodists are not distinguished by manner of speech or outward appearance. Rather, Methodists love the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and they love their neighbor as themselves. It is possible to be serious-minded about core beliefs of faith while also extending a heart of love and peace to those with whom we disagree. That is what Wesley knew how to do. Friends, that is what Paul knew how to do. And we see him writing that instruction to the church in Philippi. You do likewise. Go and do likewise. And I believe that's what we see a lot of lacking in our own day. Either we assert our own deeply held convictions, or we sacrifice those convictions for the sake of getting along with others. Neither one are a good choice. Loving one another is the best choice. Loving alike. Loving like Christ. That's the call of the Christian. We can love God. Paul knew that. And we can have good theology. We can love one another, including those with whom we cannot think alike. So we consider today, hearing Paul's letter to the church in Philippians, how do we translate today this action in our lives? How do we translate this? We'll gather tonight in this space in one of my favorite times of the year, in a baccalaureate service, which is an ecumenical service, and we'll look at our brothers and sisters from various churches, and we'll say, howdy, partner. Howdy, partner. That's how we do it. That's how we do it. And that's what I want to be known for. Amen? That kind of love is the kind of love I want to be known for. I believe it's the heart of Christ. May it be so today, in the name of our beloved Jesus Christ. I want to invite Alex and Joanna to come. I want to close this time of hearing and learning together with Philippians 1 through a different translation. This is the Message version of the scripture by Eugene Peterson. And I'll invite them to lead us in this hymn of reflection. Hear this translation. It sums this up so well. Eugene Peterson writes, Paul and Timothy, both of us committed servants of Christ Jesus, write this letter to all the followers of Jesus in Philippi, pastors and ministers included. We greet you with the grace and peace that comes from God our Father and our Master Jesus Christ. And we tell you of a love that will grow. A love that will grow. Every time you cross my mind, I break out in exclamations of thanks to God. Each exclamation is a trigger to prayer. I find myself praying for you with a glad heart. I am so pleased that you have continued on in this with us, believing and proclaiming God's message. From the day you heard it right up to the present, there has never been the slightest doubt in my mind that the God who started this great work in you would keep at it and bring it to flourishing, to a flourishing finish on the very day that Christ Jesus appears. It's not at all fanciful for me to think this way about you. My prayers and hopes have deep roots in reality. You have, after all, stuck with me all the way from the time I was thrown in jail, put on trial, and came out of it in one piece. All along, you have experienced with me the most generous help from God. He knows how much I love and miss you these days. Sometimes I think I feel as strongly about you as Christ does himself. So this is my prayer, that your love will flourish, and that you will not only love much, but you will love well. Learn to love appropriately. You need to use your head and test your feelings so that your love is sincere and intelligent, not just sentimental gush. Live a lover's life, circumspect and exemplary, a life Jesus will be proud of, bountiful in fruits from the soul, making Jesus Christ attractive to all, getting everyone involved in the glory and praise of God. I want to report to you, friends, that my imprisonment here has had the opposite of its intended effect. Instead of being squelched, the message has actually continued to prosper. All the soldiers here and everyone else, too, found out that I'm in jail because of this Messiah. That piqued their curiosity, and now they've learned all about him. Not only that, but most of the followers of Jesus here have become far more sure of themselves in the faith than ever, speaking out fearlessly about God, about the Messiah. It's true that some here preach Christ because with me out of the way, they think they'll step right into the spotlight, but the others do it with the best heart in the world. One group is motivated by pure love, knowing that I am here defending the message and wanting to help. The others, now that I'm out of the picture, are merely greedy, hoping to get something out of it for themselves. Their motives are bad. They see me as their competition, and so the worse it goes for me, the better they think for them. So how am I to respond, Paul says. I've decided that I don't really care about their motives, whether mixed, bad, or indifferent. Every time one of them opens their mouth, Christ is proclaimed. So I'll just cheer them on. To the glory of God. Amen.
She's worshiped with us for a long time now, for a couple years at least, and I have seen the fruits of God alive and active and at work in Tammy's life. Her brother Bill Tom is going to come as a witness today. If you would join me on page 33 and be reminded that it is through the sacrament of baptism that we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty act of salvation, and we are given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. And so it is with great joy that I present to you today, Mayo Church, Tammy and Cheryl Reed for baptism. Tammy, I would ask on behalf of the whole church, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord? In union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races. In church, I would ask, will you nurture Tammy in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life?
Amen.
Turning over to page 36, the Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept over the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. And when you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, you sent your son Jesus that was nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. So God, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit as we gather here. Bless the gift of this water and bless Tammy who will receive it to wash away her sin, to clothe her in righteousness throughout all of her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. Tammy, I'd ask that you kneel at the altar if you would. Tammy Cheryl Reed, I baptize you today by profession of faith in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Amen. Would you join me in praying for Tammy now? Remain here if she would, and during our closing hymn, if you would want to come and to greet Tammy yourself, you're welcome to do so. Let's turn to our closing hymn, number 714. I know whom I have believed.
Thank you.
when, but I know who. I know who. Being confident in this, that Jesus Christ, who began a good work in you, will complete it. Amen. Go in that confidence and in that grace. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.